In this video, we are going to introduce some of the key components of the immune system to provide some context upon which future videos will build. We will look at the different arms of the immune response, the major cell types involved in defending us, and some of the key functions of the immune response. The immune system is designed to keep us fit and healthy, defending us from constant threats outside the body, which can be tissue injury, for example, a cut or burn, chemicals or toxins, as well as pathogenic microbes, including bacteria and viruses that can cause disease. As well as these external threats, the immune system is constantly monitoring for internal threats, such as those that may occur when one of our own body cells becomes cancerous. We tend to take the immune system for granted, not really recognizing the fundamental role it plays until something goes wrong and we become ill. Indeed, immunity derives its name from the Latin immunis, meaning privileged. As you'll see as we go through this course, the immune system is an astonishingly complex interplay between organs, tissues, cells, and soluble proteins. And it's important that you take the time to understand how the different components of the immune system fit together and communicate with one another. In this first video, we're going to look at the different layers of the immune system and introduce some of the key players that we will then explore in more detail as we progress through the course. The human immune system can be broadly divided into two parts: the innate system, which we are born with, and the adaptive system, which develops as the body becomes exposed to microbes and the chemical mediators that they release. While we often teach each part of the immune system separately to begin with, it's important to note that these two systems are working together in parallel, and there is significant overlap and crosstalk between the two systems. The first layer of the innate system comprises a series of barriers and chemical mediators that try to prevent pathogens from entering our body in the first place, which is then backed up by a second layer of cellular and soluble components if that first line of defense is breached. Finally, the third layer is the adaptive immune system, which, although it takes longer to become activated, has a much more specific and targeted response. We can therefore think of the immune system as a bit like a military defence. The barriers are the equivalents of the minefields, trenches, walls, and floodlights that might surround a base. The innate system is the general soldiers and attack dogs that are patrolling the walls of the camp, looking for anything suspicious. And then the adaptive system is the elite troops, specially trained to carry out highly specific missions with a great degree of skill and precision. Each one of these different components and the underlying network of communication and support structures plays a vital role in defending the base, and they cannot work effectively without one another. The immune system is intelligent. It knows how to respond to different types of threat. There is no point, for example, mounting an effective antibacterial defense if the invading pathogen is viral or fungal. Furthermore, the immune system is continually learning, and as new threats are encountered, it adapts to meet and destroy these challenges, which is why we were able to defend ourselves against novel diseases such as COVID-19, which is caused by the previously unseen SARS-CoV-2 virus. The evolution of the immune system is driven by the evolution of pathogens and the need to respond and adapt quickly to maintain homeostasis and our health. What we're going to look at for the remainder of this video are the major functions of the immune system and the types of cells that help carry out these responses. Don't worry if you don't understand everything at this point. We will revisit these again in more detail as we move through the course. It's a good idea at this point to get a broad overview of the immune system as a whole. The immune system is comprised of a range of different organs and tissues, including the thymus, the bone marrow, the spleen, and the lymphatic system, amongst others. This is supported by billions of white blood cells, or leukocytes, that move throughout the body, looking for signs of tissue damage or infection. If they do detect a threat, a range of soluble mediators come into play to either help neutralize the threat, for example, the complement system, or communicate that threat to other immune cells, in the case of cytokines and chemokines, allowing for an effective immune response where individual cell types respond in a dynamic manner to specific chemical stimuli to coordinate that response. The main functions of immune cells can be broadly divided into four distinct outcomes, which are the four R's: recognize, react, regulate, and remember. Recognize, because immune cells need to be able to distinguish between threats and non-threats, which is slightly more complicated than just determining whether a cell is self or non-self, although this is an important part of the process. Essentially, the immune system needs to be able to distinguish between things that pose a threat to the body and those that do not, and respond accordingly. Hence, if a self tissue becomes damaged due to a cut or burn, it must be repaired. Or if one of our own cells becomes cancerous, it needs to be removed, just as a pathogenic microbe needs to be destroyed. Supporting this activity is a network of soluble chemical messengers that help shape the immune response. These include cytokines, which direct the immune response, and chemokines, which help direct cells of the immune system to the site of insult. Once immune cells identify or are directed towards a threat, they need to be able to react. They do this through a series of targeted effector functions, which includes the destruction of pathogens or infected cells, the removal of damaged tissue, and subsequent wound repair. The nature of the response is partially shaped by the types of cytokines and chemokines that are present in the region of the threat. The immune system is capable of huge damage, and therefore needs to be tightly regulated to ensure that the immune response is appropriate. It needs to be switched off once a threat has passed, and needs to prevent damage to our own tissue. Therefore, the immune system has a series of checkpoints built in that need to be passed for immune cells to carry out their effector functions. These often take the form of multiple activation signals that all need to be received in order for a cell to become activated, with these co-stimulatory signals helping ensure the cells only become activated in the presence of a threat and do not become active against our own cells, causing unnecessary damage. As well as activating the immune response, cytokines and chemokines have a role in switching the immune response off. They can be released from a range of different immune cells, some of which aim to dampen down the immune response and start the repair and recovery process. Finally, remember. Two families of immune cells called T and B lymphocytes have the ability to remember threats they have previously encountered, producing immune memory, which is the basis of vaccination. It allows our body to respond more effectively if the same threat is ever encountered again. The precise way immune cells carry out their roles depends on where they are found in the body, the nature of the threat, and in a future video, we will look in more detail at the anatomy of the immune system and how this helps organize the immune response. There are a wide range of different immune cells, each with different properties that need to be coordinated to produce an effective immune response. Immune cells develop from hematopoietic stem cells, which in adulthood reside in the bone marrow. But in the early stages of development, other sources are important, including the fetal yolk sac, the liver and spleen before birth, with the bone marrow becoming increasingly important just prior to birth. After birth and into young adulthood, the contribution of long bones decreases, and the main source of hematopoietic stem cells becomes sites like the pelvis, the sternum, the ribs, or the vertebrae of the spine. These stem cells follow one of two different pathways to become an immune cell: the myeloid lineage or the lymphoid lineage. The route they take is determined by a complex and specific set of molecular cues in the bone marrow. While we now have the capacity to determine what surface markers are expressed on cells, historically these cells were characterized by their appearance under a microscope. You may be able to pick out common physiological features amongst group of cells. The myeloid lineage largely gives rise to cells of the innate immune system, but also to platelets and red blood cells, or erythrocytes. Three main classes of immune cells develop in the myeloid lineage. The first we are going to discuss are the granulocytes, or polymorphonuclear cells, which comprise cells with a unique multi-lobed nucleus and numerous cytoplasmic granules containing antimicrobial peptides. Cells in this group of myeloid cells include neutrophils, eosinophils, and basophils, which are mainly present in the circulation, and mast cells, which reside in tissue. Neutrophils are the most abundant white blood cell or leukocyte, and are the first immune cell to migrate from the circulation to the site of damage or infection. They are a phagocytic cell, which means they can engulf pathogens, infected or damaged cells, or cellular debris to help contain an infection or remove damaged tissue. Eosinophils and basophils are much less common, but play important roles in producing cytokines to help shape the inflammatory immune response. Mast cells, which are tissue-resident cells, are a bit like basophils, but lack a multi-lobe nucleus, but do contain cytoplasmic granules. Eosinophils, basophils, and mast cells all play a role in the defense against parasites, which are too big to be phagocytosed by neutrophils or macrophages, which we'll discuss in a minute. In particular, they are active against nematodes or worms, but they're also implicated in allergy, which is an inappropriate immune response to a normally harmless substance, such as dust or pollen. The next group of cells are the mononuclear cells, which in the circulation are called monocytes, and if they migrate to tissues during the inflammatory response, become known as macrophages. As well as these migratory inflammatory macrophages, during embryonic development, tissue-resident macrophages arise, and these populations of tissue-resident cells self-renew within the specific tissue in which they originally developed. Tissue-resident macrophages and mast cells are responsible for the release of many chemical mediators, cytokines and chemokines, that initiate the inflammatory response and recruit additional immune cells from the circulation to the site of challenge. Macrophages are also a particularly good phagocytic cell, being able to engulf multiple infected or damaged cells. Lastly, myeloid progenitors can produce dendritic cells. But just to confuse matters, these can also be derived from lymphoid progenitors, and a small subset of dendritic cells also form from monocytes. But we will describe the main functions of dendritic cells as if they were one population. Dendritic cells are also capable of phagocytosis, but rather than for the purpose of pathogen clearance, dendritic cells engulf pathogens to be able to present part of the pathogen on their surface and then activate cells of the adaptive immune system, acting a bit like a messenger or a link between the innate and adaptive arms of the immune system. There are also some innate cells that derive from the lymphoid lineage, and these are known as innate lymphoid cells, or ILCs, and include a type of cell called a natural killer cell, which is probably the coolest named cell in the immune system. These natural killer cells play a fundamental role in the defense against virally infected cells and in the destruction of our own cells that have become cancerous. Unlike other lymphoid cells, ILCs are only able to respond to a generalized molecular pattern, and they do not have the capacity to form immune memory or remember what threats they have previously encountered. This memory is where cells of the adaptive immune system come into play, with B and T lymphocytes. The main role of B lymphocytes is to produce antibodies, which are large Y-shaped proteins that bind to pathogens with incredible specificity. They can help prevent pathogens from entering cells or make them more visible to phagocytic cells, allowing them to be engulfed and removed more easily. However, B cells require assistance from a subset of T lymphocytes called helper T lymphocytes before they become fully activated. And this is to prevent B lymphocytes from activating against our own tissue. T helper lymphocytes also release cytokines that help guide the immune response, depending on the type of threat. The other main type of T lymphocyte is the cytotoxic or killer T lymphocyte, which can destroy cancerous or infective cells. And a final group of T lymphocytes are called regulatory T lymphocytes. And these can secrete cytokines that dampen down the immune response to try and ensure it is contained and appropriate. T and B lymphocytes, once they have encountered a particular threat, are able to form memory cells, which survive for many years, and ensure that if the same threat is ever encountered again, the immune response is much more robust and efficient. So, the immune system is classically described as having three layers: the barriers that prevent pathogen entry in the first place, the cellular and soluble components of the innate immune response, and then the highly specific cellular and soluble response of the adaptive immune system. But remember, all of these are acting as one system, not in isolation. The immune system comprises billions of white blood cells, or leukocytes, that reside in tissues or circulate the body looking for any threat, communicating with one another through soluble cytokines and chemokines, which allow these cells to carry out a diverse array of effector functions. All the cells of the immune system are derived from hematopoietic stem cells that follow either a myeloid or lymphoid lineage to produce many different types of cells that work together to remove pathogens, repair damaged tissue, and restore homeostasis. As we move through this course, we will look more in depth at the various components of the immune system and how they contribute to an effective immune response.